Good morning. Good morning. Great to see you all today. Welcome to the worship service of Community Bible Church, whether you are here in our sanctuary, and we're getting a good crowd today. Very wonderful to see you all, or watching from home by live stream. We're so glad you've joined us, and we pray that our time together as we study God's Word and sing songs of praise to our great Redeemer, that you are blessed and encouraged and uplifted and edified by all that takes place today. Let's pray together as we begin worshiping this morning. Our Father, we thank you and we rejoice that you are Lord and God of all, and that we can bow to you as your children, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Thank you that you have saved us. You've written our names in the Lamb's Book of Life. You have prepared a place for us to enjoy you forever in heaven. You have left us here as your ambassadors with a great cause, a great mission to be about, of taking good news to all who will hear, to all who will listen and receive. Thank you, Father, for the good work that you want to do in our hearts as you seek to conform us to the image of your Son. Thank you that your Spirit is actively at work as we yield and surrender to you. Father, we gather in the name of the Lord Jesus, and to honor you, we gather humbly before you as your creatures, sons and daughters of the living God, to declare that we love you. We give you our loyalty, our allegiance. We proclaim your glory to the nations. We thank you that you are the one true God, a God who loves us. So this is for you. We gather for you to honor, to esteem, to exalt you. May you receive our worship, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. It is good to see you all today, and more coming in. We're just delighted to have everybody here this morning. First of all, some announcements. A big announcement to begin with, which is that Children's Church will be starting back up next Sunday. So we are thrilled that our teachers are ready to be back doing that. And so during the sermon, they get to escape that and go enjoy something that's a bit more age appropriate for them, and enjoy that teaching and folks building into their lives. And so we'll, of course, leave it up to each individual family, each set of parents, to decide if they're ready to have their child be a part of that or not. But we are thrilled to offer that and are thankful for our teachers in making that available. However, we will be canceling Vacation Bible School. You probably guessed that, since it would have started a week from today. And we hate to do that, but just in the times in which we live, with all the coronavirus and everything, we're simply not able to put it together, and we wish that we could. But we will look forward to a great Vacation Bible School next year, and so let's all be excited about that and prayerful about that. We want to be praying for the family of John O'Callaghan. This dear brother went home to be with the Lord this past week, and we celebrate with him, and we wish that there would be a service we could do that soon, but there will be a memorial service pretty far on down the road that the family will plan, and we'll be a part of that and looking forward to that. But he is in heaven, and we celebrate with him. We grieve with the family that remains behind. We grieve their loss, of course, but we do rejoice with John that he is finally home. Let's also be praying for Leska Valerius. She is right now, this morning, at Baylor Hospital here in Irving, being tested for the coronavirus. She had some symptoms that they noticed, and so they got her in to see what was going on there, and just be praying that she does not have COVID-19, and that whatever it is, they can treat it effectively, and that she can just be right back to good health and doing well. So please keep Leska in your prayers. Speaking of prayer, the ladies' prayer group, which Leska was a faithful member, is going to start meeting in person once again here at the church beginning tomorrow. They meet every second and fourth Sunday of the month. And so it'll be great to have them back in the building. They'll pick a larger room so they can spread out and honor the social distancing guidelines at this time. And if you'd like to be a part of that, please see Lita Samuelson. Did I say Sunday? So this is Sunday. So it will be tomorrow, Monday. Thank you. Feel free to interject any other things with the things that come out of Steve's crazy brain. But tomorrow it is, and that's at 2 o'clock here at the church. Is that right? Good, 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 good. Here's some fun. Softball is back. So yay, the league is starting back up. We're excited about that. We have had a couple of practices and haven't had a game, so we're looking forward to getting back on the field and having some games, and we will keep you posted about the dates and details and times of all of that. But we're excited. And finally, today is Jake's birthday. Woo! Jake! Happy birthday! I'm sensing they want to sing. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jake. Happy birthday to you. Jake, we love you. We thank God for you. What a blessing you are to our church and to me personally. You are a joy. Happy birthday. Those are the announcements for the day. Let's enjoy worshiping with the Strauss family. Thank you all for being here, and we're excited about worshiping together.
Yes, we are very excited to be here. Thank you for allowing us to do the pre-recording of our services for a couple weeks, and we're glad to be back and just do some worship with you guys. And so why don't you go ahead and stand, those of you who are here, and if you're at home, thank you again for joining us. We'd love for you to sing along, and we'll open up the heavens.
We waited for this day. We're gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. To my heart and my soul. Jesus, no sweeter name than I ever known. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. Oh, no sweeter name than the name of Jesus. No sweeter name than I've ever known. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus.
To me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Psalms 95, 2-3. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods.
Well, your presence is all I need. It's all I want, all I seek, and without it, without it, there's no meaning. Your presence is the air I breathe, the song I sing, the love I need, and without it, without it, I'm not alone. Presence is all I need, it's all I want, and all I seek, and without it, there's no meaning. Your presence is the air I breathe, the song I sing, the love I need, and God. There will be no one like you, and no one beside you alone are worthy of all praise. Just like that. There will be no one like you, and no one beside you alone are worthy of all You are my everything, and I will adore you. Yes, I will adore you.
Would you pray with me? Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much for being our God. For being a God that we can adore together, who we can lift our hearts up to you together, and we can seek you together as a family, as a people. But we need you. We are in such need of you. Lord, thank you for knowing our weakness, for knowing our limitations, and just, God, for reminding us that you are God, and also that we are not. And so we ask now that you would still our hearts, help us to be present, to remember that you are present, that when we sing to you, you inhabit the praises of your people. And so we lift our hearts again to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Be still, my soul, the Lord is on thy side. Bear patiently the cross of grief or pain. Leave to thy God to still my soul, thy God doth undertake to guide the future as he has the past. Thy hope, thy confidence, let nothing shake.
God, thank you for stilling us in our souls, our very souls, because you are on our side. Those whom you have called, you have justified, and you have sanctified. For one day we will be glorified. And we look forward to that day when we get to see one another in a new way, with new eyes and new bodies. Lord, we rejoice in the fact that that is a promise, that no matter what is happening around us today, Your promises still stand, and you still sit on your throne. We praise you now with our whole hearts, and we lift ourselves up to you, this church, and this country. In Jesus' name, amen. And you may be seated.
Thank you, Jason and family. It's good to have you back. Each step that we take to a little more familiar territory is nice. We have a bulletin for the first time in a long time. And thanks to me, it's incorrect. If you were coming here to hear Matt Downey read, you'll have to wait till next week. Our reading this morning, two passages, one from the book of Genesis, chapter 1, verses 26 and 27, says, "Then God said, 'Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the sky, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth.' And God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them." And the next passage is in Psalms chapter 8. Verses 3 through 8. "When I consider thy heavens, the work of thy fingers, the moon and the stars which thou hast ordained, what is man that thou dost take thought of him, and the son of man that thou dost care for him? Yet thou hast made him a little lower than God, and dost crown him with glory and majesty. Thou dost make him rule over the worlds, over the works of thy hands. Thou hast put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of the heavens, and the fish of the sea, whatever passes through the paths of the seas." And if you would join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, Creator, Sustainer, Savior, Father, you are magnificent. You alone are worthy, worthy of our worship, worthy of our praise, of all laud and all honor and all glory. Father, you have no peer. And Father, we thank you that we serve a God who is so powerful. We thank you that even as we may look around us and have concerns, Father, none of this takes you by surprise. Father, you are in complete control of all. Father, we thank you. And Father, as we gather together this morning, we are thankful that we can do so. Father, we are thankful that you have brought us here to rally around your word. Father, that you have given us a pastor who will exhort your words to us. Father, may your words come strongly through Steve. Father, may lives be touched. May hearts be melted. Father, it's not because of Steve, but because of your word. And you have seen fit to use him to bring that word to us, and we thank you for that. And Father, ask that throughout you would be honored, that you would be gloried. Father, that you alone would be the focus of our attention. Lord, we pray these things in the precious and the holy name of our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Paul. And next week I'll get to say, and kids are dismissed to junior church. Well, I just loved having Jason and his family up here singing. It's a joy, a pleasure. Thank each one of you. But underneath that mask of the mama is a big smile. Seeing all your kids, all your family up here leading in worship, what a joy. I know that is to your heart. Very special. Well, today I have chosen to postpone a message in Luke in our regular series and want to address the times in which we live. We have seen some grievous things the past couple of weeks. It isn't the only time that we have seen disregard for human life and other atrocious behavior, but horrific ugliness and inhumanity has certainly been on display these past few days. When I think about the death of George Floyd, which I will never forget, because a police officer pinned him down with his knee on his neck, suffocating him to death, it disturbs me to the core. I do not know how you do that to someone who is telling you over and over, "I can't breathe." And I don't understand how two other officers could actually help pin him down. It is absolutely horrendous, and thankfully this evil deed has been universally condemned by law enforcement around the country. We have seen a movement of protests, legitimate protests, rise up over George Floyd's death at the hands of a policeman and a call for justice and a call for equal treatment and respect. It's been a centuries-old battle for the black community, a battle, a struggle that most of us only hear stories about from a safe distance. But we who are white have never walked in their shoes. Maybe it's time, long past time, to take off our shoes and to put on theirs for a while and draw close and listen deeper. Listen to things you don't hear from a safe distance, if we are ever to really understand. Alongside these protests on our TV screens, we have seen some who have led in looting and the destruction of property. This too has been hard to watch. Those rioters do not represent the black community, and they do not speak for the black community. And as tragic as those events are, some will use this as an opportunity to conclude, "See, that's what those people do. That's what those people are like. That's what they will do given a chance." That's a very racist thought. If you're thinking that thought, I'm telling you right now you're in sin. And you need to deal with that before God. I also think about the death of retired police officer David Dorn in St. Louis, also a black man, who was hired as a security guard to protect a business from looters. Some from within those protest movements took his innocent life. There's nothing just about that. Nothing good or decent about that. Just like George Floyd, he too did not deserve to die. It shakes me to the core to watch all of this. It makes me angry that people can harbor such hate in their heart. It makes me angry that innocent life has been taken, that people's livelihoods have been destroyed. It makes me angry that we live in the most educated, wealthiest time in human history, and we still hold malice toward our brother. People still consider someone who looks different from them as being less worthy of respect, less worthy of opportunity, less worthy of kindness and care. And yes, I know we live in a fallen world and we all have a sinful nature, but you would think that by now that at least we have learned just some basic principles of human decency toward each other. I guess not. People used to refer to this as a civilized society. That doesn't seem to be the case anymore. It's very sad. I've never experienced racial prejudice or racial tension. I've never felt the rage inside because I was racially targeted. I just haven't. It's not the same, but I can identify with rage over rape because somebody in my family was raped. I can identify with rage over poverty because I experienced pretty deep poverty in my childhood. I can identify with rage over how people used to be treated in mental institutions because I've had a loved one go through the horror of a state-run mental institution 50 years ago in West Virginia when that was not a good place to be. I can identify with the rage over abortion, not because I've experienced that, but because the voices of those precious little ones have been silenced, so I will be their voice. They truly are the least of these. I can identify with rage over Christian persecution, at least a little, because I've experienced a bit of persecution as a Christian, mostly from my own family. But I can't identify with rage over racial injustice. I've never experienced it. But I can see the pain in my brother's face. Genuine pain. And I hurt with him. I hurt deeply. George Floyd was a brother in Christ. You will meet him when you get to heaven one day. He beat you there, welcomed by the King of Kings. And he might have a mansion up there right next to yours. I'll take that. And you know what? I bet he would like very much for you to remember him for the things that he did for Christ. George Floyd did things that will be rewarded to him in heaven. Remember that. Celebrate that. But I want to talk this morning about how we got where we are to where we are and how to get back to where we need to be once again, if we were ever there. Some of the answer to our problems today have to do with race relations, and some of it has to do with police relations. But I'm not going to be giving a history this morning of race relations, and I'm not going to get into the huge amount of good that police have done in the community or the occasional bad that some police have done in the community. The answer to our problems today is deeper than either one of those topics, though those are both important topics, and I don't mean to minimize them, but the answer is simply deeper. The answer to all of this mess and pain and struggle and heartache that we are witnessing and going through has to do with the nature of man. What is man? And the key to that question is, man is made in the image of God. And if more people could figure out what that means and how to appreciate their fellow man accordingly, there'd be a whole lot less fighting and conflict and devaluing of life and destruction of life. If I see you for who God made you to be, then I can't treat you with contempt or disdain or disrespect or hate or malice. I can't. The main passage of Scripture that talks about the image of God in the Bible is Genesis 1, 26 and 27. Let's read it again. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the sky, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. That glorious passage, that definitive proclamation from God himself, applies to every single human being who has ever lived. It is the essence of all mankind, no matter who you are, when or where you live, how much you know, how much you have, how old you are, what sex you are, what color you are, what religion you are, whatever. There is nothing that could ever disqualify a human being from being made in the image of God. Every single human being is made in the image of God, and nothing can take that away. So I want to begin by looking at how mankind, how humans, are the very pinnacle of creation. And nowhere is that stated more boldly than in Psalm 8. So let's read verses 3 to 8. This is what the psalmist says. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have ordained, what is man that you are mindful of him? and the Son of Man that you'd care for him. Yet you have made him a little lower than God, and you crown him with glory and majesty. You make him to rule over the works of your hands. You've put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, also the beasts of the field, the birds of the heavens, the fish of the sea, whatever passes through the paths of the sea. The principles of that passage are very easy to see. They're right in front of us. God made us. God made us less than himself. God crowned us with glory. And God made us to rule over the rest of creation. That means that God made us higher than anything else he created. We are the pinnacle of all creation. Now, to be clear, because not everybody gets this right, we are not gods. Sorry, Mormonism. Sorry, Hinduism. Sorry, some types of Buddhism. Sorry, New Age. We are not gods, and we don't become gods. There is one God, creator and Lord of all, and we are not him. We are his creatures. He is the creator. We're also not animals. It is only regarding the creation of mankind, of us, that God says, let us make man in our own image. And God only directly breathed into man's nostrils the breath of life. No other creature is made in God's image or had God directly breathe life into him, just mankind. That means we're unique. There's nothing else out there like humanity. We are the focus of God's special attention. We are the ones that he placed in the garden. We are the ones he sent his son to redeem from our sin. We're the ones that he's preparing the glories of heaven for, us human beings. And the Bible describes mankind as the highest created being. The Bible itself was written almost entirely about the relationship between God and man, not God and animals or stones or rocks or trees. It's certainly true that the animals and the rest of the earth on which we live also have a place in God's plan of creation. They're a vital part of his creation, but the world was created by God primarily as a place for mankind to live. He built this for us, his highest created beings. But the most important principle about mankind being the pinnacle of God's creation has to do with that little phrase in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, let us make man in our image. We are made in the image of God. Now, just so this isn't confusing, it's pretty straightforward, but when God says in Genesis 1, let us make man in our image, he's using the term man in a generic term. He's just not talking here about males. He's talking about all mankind, male, female, young, old, every race, every color, every nation. Every last human being throughout the entire history of humanity is made in the image of God. The image of God is inherent in every one of us, imprinted in the very essence of who we are as human beings. We are made in the image of God. We each, without exception, are image bearers. And you can't fully understand or accurately grasp or even begin to define human rights and human dignity apart from that phrase and the biblical worldview that surrounds it. Being made in the image of God establishes the very foundation of how we view one another and value one another. All that secular, godless society has ever given to us is the devaluing of human life. The unborn, the elderly, the infirmed, the disabled, the black man, the Jew, women throughout much of human history. It is Christians who understand that our dignity comes from him who made us, God, and how he made us in his image. So what does being made in the image of God mean? Secularists don't believe in such a thing at all. Image of God, are you kidding? It's like from some old book with a lot of dust on it on the shelf. Leave that book there. Don't touch that book. But even some Christians are confused about this. Those who would define themselves as Christian evolutionists think that the image of God has to do with our bodies, our physical bodies. That's a false assumption. God is spirit, and he's made human beings alone to also be spiritual beings. The only beings in the universe, the only objects in all of existence that have a spirit are human beings. It's us and God. The only spiritual beings that there are. If it was based on our bodies, the image of God in us would change as our physical bodies changed. For the amputee, would the image of God be less in him or her because he's missing a leg or missing an arm? For those with limited mental capacities, do they bear the image of God less than those who are smarter? For the person of a different color, Could one color of people then declare that those of a different color were somehow less made in the image of God? History tragically shows that some people have held that view, that those of different race were less than those of their race. Therefore, they felt free to enslave them or torture them or send them to the gas chamber and try to eradicate them entirely off the planet because they viewed them as being subhuman, not true image bearers. But the Bible makes no such distinction. All human beings are created in His image. All are the pinnacle of His creation. Some define the image of God as God endowing us with certain godly attributes that He doesn't give to other creatures. In particular, language, creativity, love, holiness, immortality, freedom. And those are true, but the main thing about the image of God is that human beings have a unique capacity to connect with God on a spiritual level. No other creature can do that. It is simply not in them to be able to have a relationship with God. That's why you don't find books or seminars on the Jesus Prayer for rabbits, God calling all chipmunks, purpose-driven livestock. This took some work. Pigeons progress, things like this. But it's only humans, it's mankind that connect spiritually with God, the God who made us. We alone are the pinnacle of His creation. Since that's true, that has huge implications about how we treat one another and how we value and esteem one another. First of all, we're all created equal. That's why we can celebrate that our Declaration of Independence begins with these very biblical words. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Tragically, somewhere along the way, in fact, most of the way, we have failed to live out that self-evident truth that all men are created equal. But according to the Word of God and our own nation's founding documents, we are. All of us. Which gets to my next point, no exceptions. There are no exceptions to that truth. George Floyd, made in the image of God. The police officer with his knee on George Floyd's neck, also made in the image of God. And while we certainly detest his actions, we can never say that he is an animal or subhuman or anything else that demeans the image of God in him. Some of you don't like President Trump. Well, he's made in the image of God with all of his faults. Some of you don't like Hillary Clinton or Barack Obama. Well, they are made in the image of God. And on we could go. Your worst enemy, the person who stole your lunch money, the person who teased you in school, called you names, the coworker who took your promotion, the guy who scammed you financially. We could go on with this, but it's not very fun to talk about all that. But the point is, all of them were made in the image of God. And that should really affect our attitudes, how we view them as human beings. We may not like their behavior, but we always see them as individuals made by God and in His image. And that means that we are also to treat them equally. If all men are created equal, then we are to treat all men equally. Jesus explained this wonderfully in the powerful second greatest commandment, where He said, "Love your neighbor as yourself." We love people with the love of God unconditionally, a love that isn't based on what they do, but is based on who they are. Made in the image of God. In addition to love, we also treat people equally in terms of human respect, human dignity, justice, compassion. Every person deserves to be treated that way. Proverbs 31, verses 8 and 9 says, "Open your mouth for the mute, for the rights of all the unfortunate. Open your mouth, judge righteously, and defend the rights of the afflicted and the needy." It doesn't say that we're to seek justice or deal rightly for those who like us, or those who are nice to us, or who can do us some favor in return, but to all people. So because we are made in the image of God, it is our God-given responsibility to esteem all people as God does, to value all people as God does, nothing less. The black man on the ground next to the police car in Minneapolis, the shop owner who helplessly watched his store be demolished and burned, the policeman in St. Louis who lost his life while protecting somebody else. We value all people. All are made in the image of God. But we also evaluate people's behavior, including our own. God doesn't give us principles of right and wrong, laws regarding right and wrong for nothing. He wasn't kidding about those things. He calls us to live upright lives, to shine the light of His truth and His ways in a world of darkness. I'm sinful. You're sinful. George Floyd was sinful. The police officer who killed him was sinful. Donald Trump is sinful. Barack Obama is sinful. The protester in the street is sinful. The store owner watching his shop being burned is sinful. The list goes on and on. And the only solution to our sin is the substitutionary atonement of Jesus Christ, who is the very image of God. Through Christ alone, we can be made right before God and conform to the image of His Son that we were originally created to be. Relatedly, because we are sinful, none of us are good, and none of us do good. Now, we can do some earthly good from time to time, be nice to others, help people out, give, serve, care for those in need. But we can't do good as God defines good. There is none righteous. No one. But of course, we're grateful and we commend people for the earthly good that they do. The world is better off because some people really try to do good. We want people to do good and show love and care and compassion. And conversely, we condemn those who do wrong, who perpetrate evil on others. Bishop Vincent Matthews Jr., who's the World Missions President of the Church of God in Christ, which is the largest African-American Pentecostal denomination, was being interviewed the other day, and he said this: "The indefensible, reprehensible event of the killing of George Floyd, which is just appalling all around the world, is rooted in sin. But then amid the peaceful protesters, we had anarchists coming out of nowhere, smashing and doing all types of things, and that is also rooted in sin." And then he added that for many people, it is incomprehensible the depth of man's inhumanity to man that we are witnessing. Again, image of God. We are violating the image of God in us. We don't condone wrong behavior ever. I do wrong on occasion. Ask my wife, ask Jan. And I certainly don't condone the wrong that I do, and neither does my wife. Do you want me to condone the wrong that you do? Of course you don't. You want me up here teaching God's word and helping equip us to live upright lives before Him that we might bring Him glory in what we do, what we say, how we think, our motivations. And yet, even though people do things that are wrong, us included, we love and value them because of who they are, not because of what they do. Their value and worth in the sight of God is always based on personhood, never on performance. They are people made in His image, even though their behavior can be horribly evil. But we see people treat people all the time with no respect, no dignity, no honor, no esteem. And it makes us angry when we see people do that to others, not because of anything that they've done wrong, but because of their skin color, or their ethnicity, or their mental deficiencies, or their physical deformity. If it's wrong to devalue any human being, it is particularly grievous to devalue someone because of how they look. What is the matter with us? How hateful are we? So as those who represent Jesus, in this fallen world, we more than any others are called to defend the value and dignity of all people. We must defend the value and dignity of all people. How could I not want my brother to be treated the same as me? Psalm 39 verse 14 says, "From God's throne comes righteousness and justice." From God's throne comes righteousness and justice. A couple of days ago, Dr. Tony Evans, pastor of Oak Cliff Bible Fellowship, shared some reflections about righteousness and justice and how they relate to the troubles in which we are experiencing right now. He states that righteousness and justice aren't mutually exclusive. Like you have to pick one or the other. They aren't a seesaw where sometimes you go for righteousness and sometimes you go for justice. No, righteousness and justice are twins. They go hand in hand. They're to be balanced side by side. And so Pastor Evans says this: "Righteousness is the moral standard of right and wrong to which God holds all men accountable based on His divine standard. Justice is the equitable and impartial application of God's moral law in society. Yes, God wants to protect the life of the unborn in the womb, but he wants to see justice to the life once born to the tomb. And that means, as Dr. Evans put it, we have to develop a heart that cares for our fellow man because they are created in the image of God, not because they look like us or have what we have, but because they have the stamp of divine creation on them. And so the times in which we live cause us to reevaluate what role we might play in helping promote and defend justice for all, equal value and worth for all, because that person is created equally by God. And the place to start in treating all people equally as being made in the image of God is to recognize that each person has an eternal soul, and we should long for that soul to spend eternity in heaven with us. If I really want that person to with me in heaven forever, that absolutely changes how I view that person here and now and how I interact with them as a human being who needs Jesus. It means I'm going to be looking for opportunities to share with them the greatest news that anybody could ever hear, that Jesus loves them and they can be forgiven of their sins and be welcomed into God's presence in heaven. Since that's true, any feelings of racism have to fade, because the eternal value and worth of the person and the joy of their eternal salvation tear down any differences, any prejudices, any animosity. The love of Jesus wins. That means that as an ambassador of Christ, as someone who's called to shine the light for the gospel, we cannot hinder the message and squelch the opportunity by unloving, hateful attitudes and words. Because love really is the answer. The love of Christ that provides for our salvation, the love of Christ that binds us together as human beings made in the image of God. Can I? Will I love my neighbor as myself? Because the Lord God made him in his image, and because he has an eternal soul that I should care deeply about. Equal treatment and justice are American values that we cherish and that we loudly proclaim. But too often they are not the experience of many Americans, let alone in many other places around the world. As people who follow Jesus, we must lead by example, both word and action, in how to show dignity, respect, value, and care to all people equally, for all are made in God's image, without exception. And when we see the injustices of the human heart on full display in how people treat one another in disregard for who God made them, then we join in the prayer that was prayed by Habakkuk centuries ago, which says this: How long, O Lord, will I cry for help, and you will not hear me? I cry out to you violence, yet you do not save. Why do you make me see iniquity and cause me to look on wickedness? Yes, destruction and violence are before me. Strife exists and contention arises. Therefore, the law is ignored and justice is never upheld. For the wicked surround the righteous. Therefore, justice comes out perverted. How long, O Lord? Pray with me. Father, I thank you that when you made man, you placed in us something that nothing else has. The very thought that you would endow us with your image, give us the capacity for spiritual communion with you, that you would esteem us to be the very highest of your creation above all else. We just are humbled beyond imagination. We don't have words to say, because we don't even comprehend the depth of the meaning of that. You have placed within us your own image. You created in us in the image of God. Father, I pray that as we embrace that truth, you will lead us and show us what that means in loving one another. In our families, in the church, among races and peoples and ethnicities and nations. I pray, Father, that your church would rise up and lead by godly example how to love our brother well, how to treat all people equally, how to show care and compassion, fairness and justice to all people. Forgive us, Father, for our grievous sin. Please forgive us for our grievous sin. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Steve, thank you. We thank you for your work. Thank you for your thoughtfulness, for your heart. And we want to sing happy birthday to you as well. Because in a few days, it will also be your birthday. And so we want to honor our pastor. Let's sing happy birthday to him real quick. Happy birthday
to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Pastor Steve. Happy birthday to you.
Just take that as a form of saying thank you to you for who you are, for what you are doing. We are going to finish with the final song. We're going to sing My Jesus, I Love Thee. And truly, when we offer our love to someone else, such as our brother Steve, we are, in effect, offering our love to the Father for giving him to us and for allowing us to be together in such a way, even though it's different. And it may be different for a while. We don't know. We don't know what God has in store or planned. But as we sing this song, the words are, My Jesus, I love thee. And as we sing, I'd like to challenge you to think of the word love in terms of obedience. My Jesus, I love thee. Often in Scripture, that's what it means. To love God is to obey him, to follow his word, to value what he values, to know that we as created image bearers can love other image bearers by being obedient to the Father. Why don't you stand and let's sing this together.
My Jesus, I love thee, I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer,
thorns on my brow. If ever
So thankful that you've joined us. We're so thankful that we can say hi to each other. If you're here face to face and if you're at home, try to call someone, try to say hi via text or some other way. Thank you for joining us this morning. You guys have a great day.